As it was anticipated, I'm going to talk about women at work. I'm going to cover recent and historical trends, new perspectives in the discipline, and also discuss policy options. So, women's involvement in the labor market has been one of the most important changes of the past century. And this change has involved many aspects of the labor market. So women have made very important inroads in all dimensions of labor markets. There has been convergence in employment rates with respect to men, convergence in earnings, and also very important changes in the type of jobs and occupation that men and women do. Despite this kind of very broad gender convergence, there are still important and persistent disparities between men and women in the labor market. So to give you a very simple piece of data, in the UK these days, women earn about 22% less than men, and they are 12% points less likely to be in work. In the US, the statistics are very similar to the UK, very big gender gaps and kind of smaller employment gaps. In continental Europe, the picture is sort of reversed. The gender pay gap is smaller, but the gender employment gap is a lot larger. So there are very big disparities in both prices and quantities between women and men in labor markets, which is kind of surprising because this is happening after decades of equalized education opportunities and equal pay legislation. So this is a little bit the kind of framework in which I'm going to talk today. The questions that I'm going to address today are sort of two big questions. First of all, the good news. Why? What are the factors, the good side of it, what are the factors that eased female entry into the labor market? And secondly, sort of the not so good news, what are the factors that still hinder the full convergence between men and women in the workplace? Now, of course, as always in economics and social sciences, we always need to ask, why do we care? Is it a problem? Is it something that we should care about? And then I'm going to give you a very simple answer to that. It's probably a simplistic answer, but yes, we do care about it. We should care about it. Because men and women are equally productive. If anything, girls these days invest more than boys in education. They perform better in school than boys. And therefore, if the efficient allocation of workers to jobs requires that people are matched to the jobs that maximize the returns to their skills, there is really no point in selecting predominantly from one gender as opposed that from two genders, because restricting oneself to restrict from the male pool, to be very simplistic about it, basically means that on average, the kind of people that we can select for a given job is of worse quality, so the match quality would be worse. So there is an issue of really efficient allocation of individuals to jobs in really ensuring that men and women have equal access to labor markets. Okay? A very simple answer to a huge question, yes, there is a problem if men and women's opportunities are not equalized. As I said, this is a sort of simple way to see that. There's lots of caveats that are being discussed, even in research these days, to this kind of view. First of all, educational attainment is equalized in terms of quantity, years of schooling, but certainly not in terms of quality. So these days, girls and boys are still choosing different tracks in education, and does that have an impact in labor markets? And secondly, if we are really serious about talking of economic efficiency, we should also take into account preferences, not only productivity. And if we do take into account preferences, we should really be asking ourselves, do men and women have the same preferences or not? So I'm going to be talking about a number of these aspects. So the outline of the talk is, first of all, starting from the facts. I will talk about historical trends in education, labor market, and earnings. Secondly, I will be talking about forces at work, explaining these trends, and finally, the factors that underlie the remaining disparities in the labor market. So, the facts, I will start from education. I was saying before that these days there is no reason to believe that women are less productive than men, and this is probably the main reason behind that. So, this figure gives you the college graduation rates in the US for by the age of 35, for people born between 1870 and 1980. So as you can see here, at the very beginning of the sample period, late 19th century, early 20th century, very few people were graduating among either men or women. So 5% graduation rate, almost equal across genders. Okay? Then, in the interwar period, educational attainment of both males and women started to increase extremely rapidly. But as you can see, males' graduation rate very quickly surpassed with females' graduation rate by a big chunk. So between, say, 1910 cohort and 1955-1960 cohort, men's graduation rate were significantly higher than women's graduation rate. So men were investing in education a lot more than females. But then with the baby boom cohorts, this gap actually reversed. And in current cohorts, females are more likely to graduate from college in the US than men, and than they used to be before, of course. So there is absolutely no gender gap. If anything, there is a reverse gender gap in favor for males in the rates of education. This is about OECD countries. So this figure here is a snapshot of current graduation rates among relatively young workers, 25 to 34. So this is for 2014 or most recently available data, and this is basically a cross-section of a very large number of OECD countries. In these countries, the sort of orange bars represent the graduation rate from college for men, and the blue diamonds represent the graduation rate for college for, sorry, the orange line is for women and the blue diamonds is for men. As you can see, everywhere, except in a very small handful of countries like Switzerland, China, Turkey, almost everywhere, women are more likely to graduate from college than men, everywhere in the OECD, okay? Now, this is really about the quantity of years of schooling, the probability to graduate from college. If one looks at what women and men do in college, indeed there are important disparities there. So this picture here represents the fraction of female graduates and male graduates in hard sciences. So here I'm talking about science, mathematics, and computing. So what is the distribution of men and women in the total number of graduates in these disciplines? Why am I looking at these disciplines? Because these are really the disciplines that tend to be associated with higher earnings in the labor market. Okay, so that's precisely, that's the only reason why I'm looking for the moment at these disciplines here. So as you can see here, except again in a very small group of non-representative countries here, everywhere in the OECD, women are much less likely than men to graduate from STEM subjects, from high-earning sort of majors. Okay? So this is the sort of educational snapshots. Let's move on to the labor market. I'm going to give you some data on the employment rate of women, which is basically the proportion of employed women over the total working age population, in the US and in a number of OECD countries. So let's start from the US here. This sample starts at the beginning of the 20th century. Between the beginning of the century and the start of World War II, the employment rate of women is extremely low, between 20 and 25%, and also relatively stable, relatively stagnant. With World War II, after World War II, there's been a huge ramp up and a huge acceleration of female employment from 25% to nearly 70% in the 1990s, and then it has completely plateaued or even slightly reversed after that. But in say 50 years between 1940 and 1990, female employment went from 25% to about 70%, so a huge increase. These are six big European countries. So it's France, Germany, Italy, Netherlands, Spain, and the United Kingdom. The red line here represents, again, the end of World War II. As you can see, after the end of World War II, these countries look like each other a lot. There's been an increasing trend in female participation in all these countries. The levels were somewhat different, and in particular, for example, if you compare, for example, Spain and the UK, you can see that the trend is a lot steeper in Spain than in the UK, because in Spain, the sort of beginning level of female employment after World War II was a lot lower than in the UK. So there's also been some sort of cross-country convergence in female employment rate, but very clear and positive trends after World War II. This is Scandinavia, even more. The trends in some Scandinavian countries have been extremely steep, like, for example, Norway and Sweden, and the levels are also very different from the rest of Europe. So, for example, if you compare Sweden and Norway to southern European countries, you see that these days women have an employment rate in Sweden and Norway of about 80%, while it's only 50 to 60%, for example, in Italy and Spain. Another very important takeaway point from those graphs is that this sustained increase in female employment rates that we have observed since World War II is not really a sort of historical necessity. Before World War II, and this is the reason why I put that sort of red line divide, before that, the experience in these countries was relatively different. So in many countries, female employment rates were kind of flat or even decreasing, for example, like in the Netherlands, in Italy, in the UK, and in some Scandinavian countries too. This is the so-called U-shape pattern in female participation. So if you really look at countries at very different stages in their development process, it's not always true that the association between development and female participation is monotonic. In particular, in societies, in pre-industrial societies, in which a big chunk of the labor force is employed in agriculture, in these particular societies, women are actually working a lot. They're working as much as men. And it's only when a certain economy starts to industrialize that work moves from the household and from the field into factories that women start to stay at home. So the U-shaped sort of picture, which you can see very clearly, for example, in the Netherlands, here in France, in the UK, in Italy, the declining part of this kind of U-shaped pattern corresponds to the decline of the agricultural sector and the expansion of the manufacturing sector. And then the ramp up of female participation corresponds instead to a situation in which the manufacturing sector is shrinking and the service sector is expanding. So this kind of traditional male breadwinner model and female housewife is a creation that is relatively modern. It's something that is typical to industrializing societies. Okay? So these are the main takeaway points from this kind of historical trends. I'm going to talk about earnings a little bit, not as much as I've been talking about employment, because on earnings there's much less data, especially not internationally comparable data and not very long historical trends, but we can make a very similar consideration as we've made for female employment here. So these two graphs represents the relative female earnings as a percentage of male earnings. So this is UK and US. Both in the UK and the US, there has a very clear upward trend in female earnings. So in the UK, the median woman was earning about 50% of the median man in 1970, and these days is about 83%. Similar in the US. So very strong convergence in earnings. If you look at European countries, here I've sampled France, Germany, and Italy, there's been somewhat of a sort of increasing trend, but there's two things that one need to notice. First of all, the convergence is less pronounced than in Anglo-Saxon countries, and also the level is a lot higher. So in terms of relative earnings, women are doing a lot better in France, for example, 85%, in Italy, 85 to 90%, and even in Germany, than in the US and in the UK. This is due to two main reasons. One obvious reason is that these countries in continental Europe have a much more compressed wage distribution. They are much more sort of, they have more equal wage setting policies and a much more sort of concentrated wage distribution. Which means that if you take a very broad, a very widened wage distribution, any given differences in the characteristics of working men and women becomes amplified in a country that has very big, for example, returns to education or returns to experience. While where the wage distribution is very compressed, there isn't much to sort of amplify differences in characteristics. But there is another very important force going on here. The fact that these figures here are coming from individuals who are in work, and there is a very strong selection effect on women who are actually in work. So in these countries, Italy, France, and Germany, the employment rate of women is markedly lower than the employment rate in Anglo-Saxon countries. So if working women tend to be oversampled from the high part, from the high wage section of the total distribution, then it's no wonder why in these countries the female wage gap is not that large, simply because low wage women are less likely to feature in the observed wage distribution. So it's really important to consider in conjunction gaps in employment and gaps in wages, because of course selection effects imply this kind of negative correlation between wage gaps and employment gaps. Now, there would be a lot to say about the type of jobs that men and women do, but instead of sort of going at length, for the sake of time, I'm giving you this one particular picture, and this is probably the case in which a picture speaks 1,000 words. This is a picture that refers to young graduates in the US between 1940 and the current days. So these two lines here represent the proportion of female college graduates that work in sort of typically females' occupation, teaching, nursing, librarians, social workers, or typically male occupations, sort of professionals and managerial jobs. So in 1940, about 70% of female graduates were becoming teaching, nurses, librarians, and social workers. And only like 13% were becoming doctors and lawyers and so forth. These days, if you look at current graduates, there's actually more female graduates going into managerial and professional occupation than in traditional female occupations. So the nature, the type of jobs, and the sort of financial status of jobs that men and women are doing in the labor market has incredibly converged in the past 50 years or so. Okay, so having very briefly observed these trends, what can we say about the underlying economic and social forces that brought these trends together? Again, here the literature is huge. I'm going to touch upon a few things that I think are more interesting and more active in research these days. So, of course, I've already talked about human capital investment. Women are investing in education as much as men these days, but it wasn't definitely the case, say, 50 or 60 years ago. And then there's been technological progress in all sorts of areas of work and personal life. For example, there's been important medical progress that has implied that, for example, there is birth control these days. Maternal health has enormously improved, so the whole incapacitation of women around the time of childbirth and lactation these days is kind of minimized. So medical progress has been a very important factor. But also there's been technological progress in the market, so all sorts of like brawn-saving technologies have somehow undermined the comparative disadvantage of women in physical tasks. So these days, one cannot really say that women have a disadvantage in sort of manufacturing jobs relative to men. And also the same kind of technological progress that was making production in the market sort of more efficient was also making production at home more efficient. So for example, the introduction of household appliances has replaced, in most cases, human work in the household, and the human work has been historically predominantly female work. Now, this kind of market technological progress, so very fast productivity growth, both in manufacturing and in services, was not even across market sectors. In particular, technological progress was a lot faster in manufacturing than it is in services. And in my recent work with Rachel Guy, we argued that this was one of the important forces driving gender convergence in both employment and earnings. And one very simple way to see that, to see the intuition behind this idea, is to basically look at this graph. So this panel here represents aggregate trends in working hours. The black line is sort of aggregate working hours of men and women in the US between 68 and 2009. They increase a little bit, but they're essentially pretty flat, so there is some increase. And you can see that this increase entirely came about via the increase in working hours of women, okay, between, say, 700 hours per year to about around 1,200 hours per year these days. If you look at men, there was actually a strong decline in the working hours of men. So this is the kind of aggregate trends we're talking about. So why is it interesting to think about the industry structure? If there's anything that is sort of gender biased in the industry structure, it might probably explain why the trends for female and men were actually symmetric. So for men it was falling and for women it was rising. So we argue that one important sort of gender component of the industry structure was the rising services. So this second diagram here gives you the fraction of annual hours in services. This is increasing overall for the US economy here from about 57% to more than 70%, about 78%, but it's a lot higher for women and a lot lower for men. So basically, the sector that was expanding in the US economy and in any other industrialized country around the world was the sector that was over-employing women relative to men. And indeed, if you look at what was happening to each gender, you see that for women, the whole increase in female participation, which is the black line now, took place by an increase in female hours in services. Female hours in manufacturing were always very low, and if anything, declining, certainly not rising. And instead, if you look at male hours, you see that the total decline in male hours is entirely explained by the decline in the manufacturing sector. So the fact that the service sector was expanding was basically pulling women out of the household and into the labor market, into jobs for which they had a sort of historical comparative advantage. While men who were historically working in manufacturing jobs, they were mostly bearing the burden of deindustrialization. This kind of process had a very interesting counterpart within the household. So one can think that there is a relatively close substitutability between services produced in the household and services produced in the market. And women were essentially moving from producing services in the household to producing services in the market. And we can find some evidence for that on time use data. So in the same way in which market trends were converging, also household trends were converging. So what this picture is showing is, well, first of all, the market trends. So the red line is women hours in the market, so an increasing trend, and male hours in the market. So this is women hours, and then the green line is men hours in the market, which were decreasing. So here we are just replicating the previous diagram that was just coming from the market. But then what was happening in the home is that women's hour in the home, the yellow line, were declining quite sharply from 38 hours per week. So this is like a full-time job, 38 hours per week, to about 26, 27 hours per week these days. And they were actually strongly increasing for men, from 11 hours per week, which was very little in 1965, to about 16 hours these days. Very far from a full-time or even a part-time job, but there is very strong convergence in the market. So here the idea is that by expanding the market service sector, women left the household and started to work in the sector for which they had a comparative advantage. Another very important force, on which I will talk again more when I talk about remaining disparities, and I will talk again tomorrow talking about gender norms and identity, is that during this whole period, there was a very important evolution of gender norms, expectations, and identity. So starting in 1970s, women started to have expanding horizons. So at the time in which women are making decisions about how much to invest into education, they start imagining themselves, say, 15, 20 years down the line, and they imagine that their labor market attachment will be long-term and continuous instead of like short-lived and interrupted by marriage and childbirth. How do we know that? Well, there are very important surveys of individuals' attitudes and values. And from these surveys, we learn, for example, that in 1968, about 30% of young women imagine to be in work by the age 35. Only 30% of them were thinking, okay, I will be in work in about 15 years' time. Only 12 years later, in 1980, about 85% of women were thinking that they would be in work at age 35. So it's a huge change in sort of career horizons and perspectives. As a consequence of this change in horizons, girls are delaying the age of marriage and they're delaying the age of first birth. And of course, they're also investing more in education, so they're completely closing the gaps in terms of years of education, and they're sort of narrowing the gap with respect to men in the terms of types of degrees that they're choosing and type of jobs they're gradually entering. So of course, there is an increase in women in sort of professional degrees like medical school, law degrees, MBAs, and so on. Now, this also implied a very important change in identities and social norms. So there is a transition from a situation in which women work because the family really needs the income, so a situation in which women work when the husband doesn't earn enough, to a situation in which women work because their jobs are not only a way to sort of increase family income, but also a way to sort of characterize and define one's identity and worth for society. So again, using value survey from the 1970s, we learned that women give a lot more emphasis to, say, co-worker recognition, the importance of what they do for society. And in strictly economic terms, if one estimates the elasticity of female labor supply to husbands' earnings, this elasticity switches from very strongly positive before the 1970s to actually negative after the, to very strongly negative before the 1970s to actually positive after the 1970s. So one's work is not just for the money. This is the main lesson we learn from this kind of elasticity. So then the important thing is that what happened first? The economic shocks or the change in identity. And I'm afraid I'm not going to be able to give you a definite answer on that. But there's a lot of evidence, and there's a lot of at least suggesting evidence, that there have been major economic and historical changes, not necessarily economic changes, that happened during the 20th century that led to a fast evolution in gender norms. So the main idea put forward, for example, by Claudia Golding in her AER lecture in 2006, is that there have been unexpected shocks. And here the important thing is that the shock was very much unexpected, that had long-lasting consequences to women's identity. So one thing, for example, was male mobilization during the Second World War. In the Second World War, there were areas in the US in which a very high proportion of men were sort of mobilized to the war, and therefore they left jobs in typical male occupations, like, for example, heavy manufacturing, military industry, or transportation industry. They left those jobs vacant. But given that those jobs had to be operated by somebody, they were operated by women, and women were sort of pulled in a completely unexpected and also substantial way into these jobs. But this implied that the next generation of their sons and their daughters sort of learned that women can do their jobs and that can do these particular jobs. And this implied a sort of gradually evolving social norm about the kind of jobs that women and men do in the labor market. Another very important change is related to what I was talking before about the rise of the service economy. The strong expansion of services had created jobs like clerical jobs, white-collar jobs, that were perceived to be more appropriate and more desirable for women. So they didn't have long hours as jobs in manufacturing. They were clean, they were safe. So jobs that were more female-friendly than jobs in manufacturing. And this, of course, pulled women into the labor force and also taught the future generations that they should be prepared to enter the labor force in clerical jobs and get very well trained with appropriate education in order to be suitable for those jobs. So in a sense, these changes were partly unexpected, but then they imply that the future generations had time to get geared for the entry into the labor market. Of course, this sort of became a vicious, a virtuous circle, because the exposure to working women in turn weakens stereotypes about the kind of jobs that women can do. And there is some evidence that indeed shows that observing women in the labor market and even more in sort of leadership positions in politics and in management has a beneficial effect on men's perceptions about women's productivity. I will come to that in a bit. So now, given that we have taken stock of a very broad variety of stories that explain gender convergence in the labor market, I'm going to talk a lot more about what really is kind of hindering further convergence. And this is a very important question these days, because despite all the nice trend that I've shown you so far, I was also showing you that starting from the sort of late 20th century, 2000s, this convergence has very strongly decelerated, if not completely stopped in some countries. So we need to understand what's going on there. So, as I said before, gender convergence doesn't seem to be very easily extrapolated to future decades, and in particular, women remain underrepresented in high-status, high-income occupation, despite, as I said before, equalized education opportunities and equal pay legislation. What kind of disparities we are talking about here? So this figure I'm giving you here represents the earnings gap between men and women in OECD countries. And to have sort of comparable data across countries, this is just differences in earning. So it's not just wages, it also takes into account differences in hours, and only selects full-time employees. So by selecting full-time employees, this is very much a sort of understatement of the total wage gap between men and women, because of course part-time workers tend to earn less on an hourly basis than full-time workers, and even more on a sort of earnings basis. So as you can see here, if you take out these sort of three outliers with a 20% or 30% wage gap, and another few outliers here with a wage gap below 10%, there is a huge middle section of countries in which the earning gap is a solid 15%. Okay, so 15%, strongly significant, strongly persistent, and then the main question is, why does that happen? So I'm going to talk here about three most active areas of research these days. The first one is gender differences in preferences and psychological attributes. So do men and women want different things? And if they want different things, there is nothing one can do about equal pay legislation, workplace practices, and so on. If they want to do different things, there is no reason to expect that men and women will behave equally in the labor market. The second point is basically looking at the mirror image of what I've just said. I've been talking about gender norms evolving substantially after World War II, but apparently they haven't evolved enough. So what is it about gender norms that is hard to change, and how are gender norms formed? And also I will talk about work-life balance considerations. So given that men and women, they typically take different roles in the household, and especially different roles with childcare, what kind of impact does it have in the labor market, and what are the sort of policy responses that we can think about? So let's start about preferences and psychological traits. This is a relatively new area of research. So the state of the art up until, say, the 1990s was mostly looking at primary factors of gender inequalities like productivity and discrimination. So if you take the 1999 Labor Economics Handbook chapter by Anthology and Blank, they were mostly looking at differences in productivity related to differences in human capital accumulation and discrimination in the workplace. Okay. After the 1990s, there has been a very important change in this particular area of labor economics, not because these first-order factors became less important. If anything, discrimination in some areas of the labor market can be believed to be very much alive, but mostly because there have been developments in other areas of economics that have enabled economists to ask completely new questions about gender differences. So there have been very important advances in the psychology literature and the growing influence of this literature in economics that have pushed economists to ask new questions. So for example, asking questions about, do men and women want different things from their labor market experiences? Do men and women want different things in life more generally? And also there have been very important empirical developments, mostly in lab experiments, field experiments, but also, for example, administrative data, extremely rich new data becoming available that have put economists in the position to address those questions. It's not that economists were probably not interested in those questions before, it's just that they didn't have the evidence to make causal inference on that. So this literature, precisely by building up on these both theoretical and empirical developments, this literature has focused on different gender attitudes in risk-loving behavior, competition, negotiation, and sort of social preferences, altruistic preferences. Now, why am I thinking about these particular traits? Of course, men and women may differ in their food tastes, for example, but we don't care about it. We really care about those tastes that might be most strongly related to labor market success. So we may think, for example, that attitudes towards risk or attitudes towards altruism may interfere with men's and women's labor market success. So let's start about risk here. Is it true that men and women have different risk attitudes? Is it true that women choose safer options in general? This is an important question because typically the labor market rewards very risky careers with higher expected earnings in any kind of sector. And if you look at a number of experiments conducted in the lab, you can see that typically women are much less likely than men to choose risky payoffs. For example, to choose payoffs that are denominated as lotteries as opposed to sort of straight payoffs. So there is a very interesting survey by Crozon and Nisi that surveys a bunch of experiments in this literature that show that women are much more risk averse than men. There's also the question about differences in competition. Of course, high profile careers, they build up in a highly competitive environment. And if you look at lab experiments, you typically see that women prefer not to compete against men, even when are equally able as men. So it's not just a matter of believing that you're worse than the other gender. It's not a matter of being worse than the other gender, and therefore you don't want to compete against the other gender. Even at sort of zero gaps in ability, women prefer not to compete. And again, there is a number of experiments here. So there is this very well-known paper by Needle and Westerlund that look at the way in which boys and girls perform in some very simple math games. So it basically means adding up five numbers, two-digit numbers, adding them up. and then being rewarded according to whether they get the right answer or not. So first of all, what they do, they test all these kids one by one by looking at how good they are in simple math, and then they have a score for each man and woman about how good they are in simple math, and then they ask them, would you like to be remunerated by only what you do in this test, or remunerated relative to what everyone else does? And then women are less likely to choose the sort of relative performance option. Women are less likely to compete. So the most plausible explanation here is that men tend to be more overconfident than women. But again, we cannot really extrapolate all that much from these results, because other research has shown that stakes matter, and also it matters against which you tend to compete. So for example, there is this paper that shows that when stakes are low, women perform better against women. When stakes are high, women perform better against men. And stakes, of course, are very important, because whenever you want to extrapolate from a lab experiment to the labor market, the kind of stakes we are talking about are completely different. There are other psychological traits that economists have been looking into. For example, women's attitude towards negotiation. In many cases, you're not going to get a promotion or a pay rise unless you ask for it. So if women don't ask, of course, they would remain behind the earnings ladder. And there is some evidence that shows that women are less likely to initiate negotiations in lab games. Also, in the same kind of lab experiment, women may be more likely to be sort of socially minded. They may care more about the payoff of the other party, and therefore they may share in a different way a given endowment. They may share this kind of endowment in a different way from the way in which men would share this endowment. Now, instead of sort of expanding my discussion about this kind of lab experiments, I would like to give you two main caveats towards the interpretation of this evidence on gender preferences. First of all, where are these preferences coming from? And secondly, what are their consequences? So what are the causes and consequences of gender preferences? So the main question about the cause is, like, is it nature or is it nurture? And this is important for policy consideration because, for example, if we see that the way in which boys and girls are nurtured, say, in primary school, induces different behavior in the labor market, then one may think, one may sort of design the appropriate intervention in primary schools. So what do we know about nature or nurture differences between men and women? One very important thing to notice is that although men and women are physically different, technological progress and medical progress has probably completely eliminated biological differences. Not biological, but they have almost completely eliminated the impact of these biological differences in the labor market. So for example, the disruption, the kind of incapacitation around childbirth and breastfeeding is these days probably minimized. Okay, this is one thing. But then, of course, there are more subtle differences between men and women that are not simply related to having kids and breastfeeding them, that are instead related, for example, to the structure of sex hormones. So this is something that is much more difficult to observe, and it's also sort of difficult to relate to labor market behavior. But there are these days some studies that particularly correlate the presence of testosterone in one's saliva to economic behavior. So I'm just giving you the results from one experiment with about 80 men. These 80 men are tested for the amount of testosterone, taking a sample from their saliva, and then they're asked to perform some risk investment with a relatively limited endowment. And it is shown that in this diagram that there is a mild but positive correlation between the amount of testosterone in your saliva and the dollar amount investment in this kind of risky lottery. Okay, so this would speak in favor of sort of nature differences between men and women, although we really don't know where it comes from, this kind of difference in testosterone level. So it may trace back to something that we don't know what it is, how much nature or nurture there is in that. Speaking towards the opposite view, the view that there is a lot in terms of nurture differing between men and women, is this paper here by Nisi and co-authors that takes a very ambitious experiment of testing competitive attitudes in two completely different societies. One is a patriarchal society. It's the Maasai tribe in Tanzania, which is completely sort of traditional and patriarchal. And the other one is instead a matrilineal society, which is the Khasi tribe in Northeast India. And just to give you the sort of stereotype description of these two tribes, I'm going to give you two quotes. So in the Maasai tribe, women sort of complain because they say that they're treated like cattle, while in the Kazi society, men complain because they say we just play the role of breeding bulls and babysitters. We don't do anything else in society. So the experiment is performed in both scenarios. So among the Maasai people, a much bigger proportion of men here chooses to be remunerated in a very simple experiment by relative performance evaluation, so with the competitive kind of option, while about half women do so. So here, traditional patriarchal society and very traditional choice of competitive payoff. In the matrilineal society, actually the gender gap is reversed. Women in the matrilineal society choose the competitive option more often than men, and even if slightly more often than men in the Maasai society. So this very much speaks towards the importance of nurture forces, the importance to the social environment in which girls and boys are brought up into making choices that are economically important. The second important sort of caveat that one needs to make when learning lessons from lab experiments on psychological traits is that one really needs to think about consequences in the labor market, not just in the lab, but what are the consequences of this trait, what are the consequences of these results for the real labor market scenario. So the key question here is whether we are making a very long leap from the lab, a lab experiment in which the stakes are low, in which the subjects might not be entirely representative of working men and working women, and most importantly, in which the environment is short-lived. There isn't that sort of day-to-day, repeated, and long-term interaction that we observe in the labor market. So can we really extrapolate those results into situations that are indeed economically meaningful for men's and women's careers? So the ultimate test for these psychological theories is whether they indeed get replicated in real-life scenario. And the evidence here is very much in its infancy. There isn't very strong evidence that the kind of psychological traits we observe in the lab, they translate one for one for what we observe in the labor market. I'm giving you just two examples here. As I said before, there isn't a huge literature on this topic. But for example, if you take a sort of real-life experiment in Israeli schools, so this is an experiment studied by Victor Lavie recently, you can see that female and male teachers do equally well under tournaments, which is an extreme case of competitive performance evaluation, so there is really no gender differences in very competitive evaluation scenarios. Now, of course, one can think of a criticism to this kind of experiment. It is true that lab experiments may not be fully representative of the labor market, but this experiment refers to the teaching profession, a profession that is historically like a female profession. So if anything, this is very much the profession in which we expect women to behave sort of competitively and confidently, more than, say, in investment banking. So we don't have a similar experiment for investment banking. This is, again, another very interesting field experiment in which different job ads are sort of, they are assigned randomized information about the process of wage formation. Some job ads state that the salary is negotiable, other job ads, they just give a take it or leave it wage offer. And in this case, it seems that women are more likely to apply to jobs in which there is no negotiation. So as you can see, the evidence on the labor market consequences is relatively mixed. So what can policy do if there are these kind of differences? If really these differences are confirmed in the labor market, what can policy do about it? Well, issues about negotiation or competitiveness can be probably addressed to some extent by human resource practices, to some extent. So human resource practices, for example, relating to information that is given to employees can somehow undo, to some extent, the kind of competitive and negotiating behavior of women and men in the workplace. For example, if one has in place information policies giving feedback on relative performance of various employees, prevalence of negotiation, pay rise, wage structures, and so on, this probably helps women and men to find the sort of right position in the kind of distribution of employees. And then another issue is, of course, affirmative action or quotas targeted at high-performance women within organizations, for example, quotas in politics, quotas in company boards. Now, we should stress here that this kind of affirmative action policies are strong distortions to market allocation. So they're almost like an extreme form of taxation on male work in these occupations. It's like taxing male work at 100% and only making these jobs available to women. So are these kind of distortions sort of valuable? Do they achieve the impact that we would like? It really depends what is the underlying barrier to the entry of women in certain professions. If the entry of women is on the labor demand side, for example, due to social norms or discrimination, then probably this kind of affirmative action policies help women enter in like financially rewarding profession. And by doing that, they may also help women, the entry of women in this profession, change and sort of evolve social norms. If instead the constraints come from the labor supply side, there is not a big enough pool of well-qualified women for that particular sort of protected job, then quotas may actually backfire, because by selecting only from one pool, one may attract a sort of lower quality pool of hires and therefore reinforcing the sort of stereotypes that women are not good enough for certain professions. Another important question about having gender quotas in sort of highly important occupations, occupations, for example, in politics and in managerial jobs, is really to understand how the formation of teams with a different gender presence has an impact on decisions percolating down, for example, company policies or decisions made in politics. So of course there is, for example, there can be some evidence, there is some slight evidence at the moment on the fact that gender boards in which there is a higher presence of women, they make different decisions about, for example, human resource practices, about hiring and firing practices. And there is also some completely different evidence coming from Italian academia that shows that a higher presence of women in committees, in academic committees for promotion, actually lowers the chances of women being promoted to associates or to full professions. So the research in this kind of areas of quotas and positive discrimination is very much divided at the moment. It's still not clear cut. Okay, I will talk next about work-life balance motives. And again, we have seen before that when looking at the data, there was strong convergence in female and male role, both in the household and in the market. But this kind of work-life balance motive is still there because those kind of trends in the household have not converged. So women remain the primary provider of childcare, elderly care, and other household roles. And this kind of role of women inevitably has some labor market effects. One very simple way to see that women, being the primary providers of childcare, also bear some kind of burden in their labor market prospects is to observe a very simple piece of evidence that childless women are very similar to men. In many countries, many scenarios, childless women are extremely similar to men. So typically, the wage gap between men and women either starts altogether or expands enormously at the time of first childbirth. So this is results from a recent paper by Henry Kleven and co-authors that takes Danish administrative data and follows couples from before the time in which they have their first child for about 10 years after first birth. So as you can see, before birth, this red line here represents birth, the trend in total earnings of men and women are completely flat. So there is no asymmetry in the trends of female and male earnings. But after birth, there is a very strong gap building up almost immediately after birth and staying there persistently and almost constant for about 10 years. And actually, the paper extends it further to 20 years. So as you can see, the arrival of a child implies a gap of about 20%, which never goes away, in the earnings of men and women. How does that happen? That happens across all possible margins in the labor market. So women are less likely to participate altogether after birth. If they participate, they are working fewer hours, and if they work, they earn lower wages. So the fact that this huge gap builds up very strongly after childbirth probably puts some doubts, probably puts some sort of burden of proof on those explanations about innate psychological differences, because then why didn't the gap show up very strongly before that? So unless this kind of psychological differences turns on the moment a woman has a child, then of course it's a lot more difficult to explain differences in labor market with innate differences between gender. What I've shown you before was data from Denmark, which are all the more surprising because one would think that Scandinavian countries, and especially Denmark, has in place some relatively gender-neutral family policies and a relatively equal approach to labor markets. They refer to the average worker, so these are really data that represent the whole population, and this is the beauty of this kind of administrative data set. What I'm going to show you next is something completely different that comes from the very, very top of the distribution of males and females earning and refers to a very small and selected sample of graduates from a top business school in the US. So the kind of work-life balance consideration that we have observed for the average worker in Denmark, do they still hold for people at the very top of the wage distribution? And by emphasizing this the fact that these people are in the sort of top earnings echelons of the distribution, I want to emphasize this, the fact that for these people, it's extremely easy to outsource to the market any aspect of childcare and home production they want. It's not an issue of budget constraints. So how are these guys behaving towards work-life balance considerations? So this study here, as I said before, refers to a top business school in the US. And the reason to look at these particular types of graduates is, first of all, to remove any kind of budget constraint out of childcare, cleaning, cooking, gardening, and so on, but also to look at the impact of work-life balance consideration in careers in which the long hours culture and the continuous sort of work attachment, the continuous involvement and the competitiveness may be particularly detrimental to men and women who want to have a sort of solid presence in the household. So, what do we learn from this study? This study has a relatively small sample, so we're not talking about Danish registry data. Of course, we're talking a small sample of graduates, but we have extremely good information on this sample, extremely precise information on exactly what they've done before graduating from the MBA and for the 10 years after graduation. So the moment when these guys graduate, if you look at male and female mean earnings, so these two solid line here, upon graduation, year zero, men and women are almost identical. There's only a very small difference in their earnings that is totally explained by the fact that during their MBAs, they might choose slightly different tracks. So men take more courses, for example, in finance, and women take more courses in, say, human resource management. But the gap here is extremely small. 10 years into graduation, there is a gap of about 50% in the earnings of men and women. So how do these guys go from being identical to be 50% difference 10 years on? And if you look at the very high flyers, so people in the 90th percentile of this already very strongly selected sample, at the 90th percentile, men, after 10 years, earn about three times as much as women at the 90th percentile. Okay, so what's going wrong during those 10 years? What are these men and women doing differently during those 10 years? So given that this is an extremely rich sample in which we know everything about what these guys were doing during these 10 years, we can see from this table here, I hope that it's readable, what is the difference, what are the differences that are building up in the first 10 years after graduation. The most important difference here is the share of people who are working at all. After 10 years, 17% of women are not working, only 1% of men are working. 40% of women have taken some career break, which is a lot, a big proportion, only 10% of men have taken career breaks. And this is precisely the type of career in which these breaks are extremely penalized. So from these regressions here, you can see that if you don't control for anything after 10 years, there is about a 56 log points gap between men and women. If you control for all these variables relating to actual labor market experience, which itself relates to the presence of kids, you can see that you explain most of it. So what can policy do in this case? Now, if we think about work-life balance consideration, it's very easy to observe that most OECD countries have in place extremely generous sort of parental leave entitlements. And in most cases, not all, but in many cases, these entitlements are almost gender neutral. There is subsidized childcare, and there is actually now starting some kind of trend in workplace practices to make them more family friendly. Now, the impact of all these policies is actively debates. In the sense, it actively debates in the sense that the advocates of these policies think that, for example, maternal and parental leave in general help women to reconcile careers with motherhood. So, for example, the fact that the U.S. is particularly sort of stingy in the adoption of these policies is often quoted as one of the causes why the employment rate of women in the U.S. completely stopped converging to the employment rate of men since the 1990s. On the other hand, this kind of policy can have unintended consequences because there might be some career cost of long absences from work, and also this can be factored in employer beliefs about female attachment to their jobs. And this may especially impact representation of women in sort of high financially rewarding jobs. And indeed, again, if you look at the comparison between Europe and the US, it is true that in Europe, the representation of women in high-flying jobs is lower than in the US. Now, this is a very simple picture that gives you an extremely coarse correlation between the length of the maximum leave available to mothers after birth and the gender employment gap in prime-age workers. There is a very strong negative correlation across OECD countries, so countries with very long parental leave are countries in which men and women have very similar employment rates. Now, there is a very strong caveat to interpret that kind of relationship causally. First of all, this relationship is not monotonic, so at short duration, maternity leave is correlated positively to female employment. At very long duration, the correlation starts to drift into negative. But also causal inference is extremely delicate. So for example, countries that adopt very generous maternal leave policies, they may do so because there are other changes, for example, social changes, women empowerment, and other changes that drive together both employment rates and female policies. So the correlation might be sort of spurious, driven by something else. There can be sort of reverse causality. Women decide to work more, and therefore they demand maternal leave policies. And also it's very hard to sort of disentangle the effect of different policies, because typically policies like maternal leave and subsidized childcare are introduced not in an independent way. So if you take micro studies that take this kind of causal identification more seriously, you see that longer maternal leave simply delays the return to work of women, keeps them attached to their jobs, but delays return to work and doesn't have any impact in the long run. So the beneficial impact of maternity leave is greatly overstated in cross-country data. There is actually other types of policies on which evidence is a lot more positive. So for example, it is shown both in the cross-country comparisons and in micro-studies on individual data that subsidized childcare has a more beneficial impact on female employment, and also in-work subsidies have a more beneficial impact on female employment. A possible interpretation is that while maternal leave policies allow women to combine career and motherhood, but at the same time they may reinforce the role of women as the primary provider of childcare, subsidies to childcare actually introduce a substitute to maternal childcare. So that may weaken the sort of stereotype about women being the primary providers of childcare. Workplace practices, 5 minutes, thanks. Workplace practices, I've been talking about it before when I was looking at the study on MBA graduates. It is true that the labor market remunerates the long hours culture, continuous attachment, and competition. So these are all job specifications that might be particularly unfriendly to women. So one point in any sort of career, even very competitive career, would be to sort of restructure those jobs and remunerate these jobs in a way that is less female unfriendly. So once I was talking to a sociologist about this matter, and she was telling me, you really have to think about women as dual job holders. And for the typical woman, the job in the market is her second job. The primary job is in the house, so that would help you understand what kind of policies in the workplace would help women to sort of be more involved in the workplace. This is a piece of evidence that is coming from a very recent paper by Claudia Golding. This is what Claudia Golding was calling the last chapter of gender convergence. This figure here correlates the long hour culture, which is basically the elasticity of annual income with respect to weekly hours, what kind of sort of premium you get for working many hours, and correlates that to earnings gap for graduates in these particular jobs. So these many jobs come from different sectors of the economy, health, business, tech, science, or others. As you can see, there is a very clear negative correlation across these jobs between the share of the remuneration that comes from working long hours and the gender pay gap. So what Claudia Golding concludes, that really the source of this kind of inequalities comes from the workplace, and the fact that there are some professions, for example here, close to the origin of this diagram, in which there is no long hour culture and there is no gender pay gap. So the example that she makes very famously here is the profession of pharmacists. Now, the thing here is that I would like to make a backward step and really make us think that this kind of long hour culture would not be a female problem or a mostly female problem if gender roles were symmetric in the household. If men and women did exactly the same stuff in the household, then the long hour culture wouldn't be more detrimental to female careers than it is to male careers. So this brings us to the last sort of topic that I want to talk about today. In the sake of time, I will be brief here, but tomorrow there's going to be almost 2 hours on this topic, or an hour and a half in my lecture tomorrow, which is the evolution or the incomplete evolution of gender norms and identity. So the thing, as I was saying before, the work-life balance considerations are perceived as a female problem insofar as social norms induce asymmetric gender roles in the household. And the impact of these gender roles in the labor market can be grasped very easily by looking at correlations between the number of people who believe that women's place is in the household. And how do you find out about how many people believe that? There's questions in work value surveys about working women being able or unable to be good mothers, whether men should always earn more than women, whether scarce jobs should go to men first instead of women. So people who say yes, who answer yes, who agree with this kind of statement, the number of people to do so is very strongly correlated both over time and in the cross-section to female employment in the labor market. Again, I don't want to extrapolate causality here. Causality will come tomorrow because a lot of that is sort of exposed rationalization. Probably if you've never worked in your life and you're asked about whether working in the household is as fulfilling as working for pay, you're more likely to say yes than somebody who has worked in both places. Now, this picture summarizes what is the importance of gender norm with sort of tighter identification, I should say. This picture gives you the distribution of household income. It gives you the relationship between the share of women in total family income and basically the fraction of families of that particular type in the US economy. So as you can see here, how should we read those graphs? In 1970, if you see the proportion of families in which the woman earns less than the man, between 0 and 50%, have a lot higher density, a much bigger density of population, than families in which the woman earns more than the man. But the very interesting thing is that there is a huge drop in the density exactly at 50%. So what's special about 50%? At 50%, the gender of the breadwinner switches from male to female. And the fact that there is a big fall in there implies that this is really a kind of transition from the male breadwinner to the female breadwinner towards which society has a strong sort of obstacle. Okay? And this kind of drop is there in the 70s, in the 80s, in the 90s, and in 2000. It's always there. It's getting only slightly smaller. Okay? So what can policy do about norms? Norms are extremely persistent, and it's hard to tell whether policy can do anything about norms, although there is also some evidence coming from different scenarios that policy indeed has a bite on social norms. So first of all, as I said before, exposure to female workers, so women working in the labor market, female leaders in politics and in management position. There is evidence from World War II, for example, observing one's mother working in the labor market and in sort of male-dominated sectors implied a change in males' preferences towards the kind of women they wanted to marry in their adulthoods. Exposure to female politicians in Indian villages has changed male perception about female capacity in politics and has also eased the entry of women in local politics. But for example, the experiments of gender quotas in company boards in Norway, they have indeed implied a higher female representation at the top in those companies, but without any effect percolating down to lower layers in those companies or even outside those companies. So again, the evidence is sort of mixed about this kind of quotas. The sort of bad news is that there's also some paper by Elisina, Giuliano, and Nunn that shows that there is some extremely long-run component, also almost prehistorical component of gender norms that we still observe these days. So basically, the gender roles introduced by the adoption of the plow 1,000 years ago are still visible today because countries in which the plow was more heavily used are countries that have more gender unequal norms. Okay, so in the sake of time, I will conclude very briefly. I started this talk by saying that women have made fast and steady progress in the labor market throughout the past century, but there are important gaps still remaining in terms of earnings, occupations done by men and women, especially at the top of the wage distribution. The research has showed us very important messages about public policies or workplace practices that can address those disparities. So there is a lot that we have learned from recent research. There is a lot that we still have to learn, for example, about interactions between the household and the market. Now, the bad news here is that some of these identified factors, like gender norms or innate differences between men and women or inertia in workplace practices, are extremely slow to evolve. The good news is that indeed, with richer data and further research, we can learn a lot more about policy. Okay, I will stop here. And I'm very happy to take questions and comments.